Hello, welcome back to another episode of the Film Hackers Talk Show. Happy Independence to you and yours. Happy birthday, Bana Uganda. It is our happy birthday and we're very excited about that. If you're one of those people who are like, Uganda and Jikoi, just for today, let's pretend all's well. And in the spirit of all is well, that is the goal that we try to do here at Film Hackers. We have a website with every kind of information, content. If you are creative, this website will definitely hook you up. We profile the people that you need to know when it comes to creative production, when it comes to everything to do with film, and not just in Uganda, but I think we've done a good thing to spread out how far our work has gone. And you can see some of that on the Film Hackers website, the Film Hackers social media pages, and today, and this show would not be possible without Net Studios Africa, Incredible Media, and Garage Group. My name is Maritza, I am your host, and the best part about this Friday is it's a public holiday, so I assume there's no pressure where you are, right? You're not, you know, rushing to finish lunch. You're not rushing to get back in a meeting. You're not sneak watching us under your office desk. So I expect everybody to be part of this conversation. And today's conversation is very important because we get into a lot of things we love so we can make money without hating ourselves. Does that make sense? So passion is supposed to also feed you. That is the idea. That is the goal. But the thing is, the things we want to do cost some money. And today we are having a conversation on budgeting and costing in production. The panelists today are go far and wide. Some are on opposite sides. I don't know if we'll need a referee mid-show. We'll see what will happen, but I'm very excited because they are not just decorated, but they are also very, very talented, and they've been in the industry for some good time. I think I'm the only newbie on this panel. So I'll ask the questions, they'll do the talking, and you can also ask some questions as well. Welcoming to the show, very excited. She is talented. She has, I think, 3 Best Actress Awards. It was almost back to back there because she came 2015, 2016. Sabula came back 2018, and it was an amazing thing to see. I'm very excited to welcome to the show actress, director, writer. Has she crossed to director? I know she's a writer, very good writer, but let's speak it into the future. And very excited to welcome the person behind Veronica's Wish. Oh my God, the list is long. Should I? You have time? I go through the whole list. I'm very excited to welcome to the panel Nisha Kalema, and she will also introduce herself in a little bit. Hi, Nisha.
Hi, darling.
She's beautiful. Did I leave that one out?
She's so beautiful. It seems like I was enjoying you introducing me, so go ahead.
I continue.
Yes, please.
Nisha Kalema started out in Uganda, somewhere in the corner. Okay, let's move on. I was stalling, bro. I think you actually tell us about yourself. So let me not dampen your CV. I can't wait to hear from her. That is Nisha Kalema. I'm very excited that she is on our panel today. And on my right, my immediate right, I am very excited to have with us another decorated award winner. I think people in film just go around collecting awards because every time I have to introduce someone, I'm like, they have this award and that award from this place. So that's a good thing. It's very promising. So an award from Sundance Institute, Durban Film Art, and he is known for works like Reflections, Felistas, Fable, Divisions as well. Is that 2007?
2008.
Mm. Yes, so he's been around for a while. He's a creative entrepreneur, a writer, and a director. I am very excited to introduce and welcome to the show Mr. Nathan Magola.
Hey.
Handsome. Why do I leave out the important detail? Young, handsome man. Rich, young, handsome man. He's here with us today talking money. And to my immediate left, let me tell you a story about this gentleman. This gentleman gave me so much headache in the name of producer. But all is well because the product was legit and you can always trust that the work that he puts his hands in will definitely be impeccable. And Discover Uganda speaks for itself. Pressbox speaks for itself. We have producer all the way from NTV. He's also a cinematographer and also a creative controller. Is that what they call you guys? Creative engineers, eh?
Creative engineer.
That's the man. Welcoming to the show, Mr. Sean Stewart Segawa.
Thank you.
Again, handsome, young, handsome man. Still single? Huh? Let's make things work. Break some boundaries. Speaking of breaking boundaries and barriers, someone actually described him to me as a very bold and innovative man. Like, he's a smart man. He's very bold and innovative, and he goes out of his way to make sure that we get premium content. When you say premium content, you think, the camera is perfect. Not just that. Yes, the aesthetics are great, but also the content has value and substance. And I'm very excited. It's an honor, actually, for me to introduce and welcome to the show CEO of Kunta Productions. He's responsible for Dance Off. The list is so long. What's the kids show? I forget the name of the kids show.
The kids show. Smart Kids?
Smart Kids, yes, Smart Kids as well. Yeah. Such a long list, and he's done an absolutely amazing job in production the last couple of years. In case you had forgotten, former artist, are we going to tap into that? Welcoming to the show, Mr. Eric Lubwama. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
I think let's start with you. Give us a brief about yourself, your work as a producer, Kunta Productions, just like a little bit about, more about you.
Yeah, I learned from the streets. I'm one of those guys, you know, never went to school for that. It's purely passion. Mm. I had the background of creating things and bringing them to life. Professionally, I'm an architect, so if you understand what the architect does, it's similar to what production is. So my inspiration has always been, you know, seeing a lot of Ugandans and Africans on TV. Mm. Yeah, I got fed up, you know, not that I don't like them, but, you know, I got fed up of seeing strange faces on our TVs. So yeah, that's the mission. But then also I believe, you know, Africans, we can tell our stories better because we understand them. Why should someone come and tell our own stories? Mm. So for me, you know, it lies at the center of that. And maybe thirdly, the whole Western culture, you know, drift towards Africa. I'm not a fan of that. So I feel like the only way to have impact is through film, TV and content. Because I mean, that's the new mother, that's the new dad to all our kids, you know. So yeah, that's why I'm here.
Wow, they say it takes a village. He has decided to put the village on the internet. I like it, I like it. Yes, Sean, tell us a bit about yourself.
All right, Sean Stewart Sega is my name. Thanks for the brief intro. I'll not speak much because I'm trying to keep the budget cartoon here. So basically, not so far from Eric here, I learned a lot of stuff from the streets. However, as I grew up, I got the opportunity to advance and understand a bigger prospect. Of course, I had to learn and unlearn a lot of things, entered the corporate world, worked with Vision Group before, worked with Media 256, incredible. I've worked with quite a lot of companies, now with NTV. Mm. So the journey is good. And for me, I would say, I would also want to see the African story told. But most importantly is that I would love to see a space where we have a lot of talent, we have a lot of abilities. I would want to see a space where we flourish because Africa is the next generation in that space.
Nice. Thank you for that TED Talk. Okay.
The TED Talk.
The production in that intro was, all right, come through. Yes, sir. Nathan.
I'm a man of many talents. No, I don't need to brag. I'm just, I'm humble. Yes, so of course, different people know me for different things because in the last couple of years, I spent a lot of my time working in advertising. So I'm an advertising creative. I've been writing commercials in three agencies, I think. There was ZK, doing commercials for Zane. UHMG, you know that whole section, get off the section network. And then I went to work at an agency called Limelight. I was writing ads for Stanbic, was that Sadolin, and then UTL. And I spent some time also at Fireworks doing ads for National Social Security Fund and Centenary Bank. But then on the side, I was doing my films because I had a company register called Entice Media Works. So I was doing the films and then also producing commercials for on a freelance basis. And after some time, I went to work at Fenon Entertainment. So actually, for the last 5 years until January this year, I was working at Fenon Entertainment as head of video, but I was also writing the commercials. Then in January, I quit and I had registered another company, which is called Eva Julia Productions. So under that right now, I'm working on a TV series for Power Magic.
Nice. It's impressive.
Yeah.
Nisha is scared.
It seems like whatever he was doing before Fenon, I had no idea I had art in me. So my art started when he joined Fenon.
Really?
Exactly.
Please, tell us.
Yes, my name is Nisha Kalema. I'm an actress, I'm a producer and a writer. I will not call myself a director yet because, I mean, I love to call myself what I know I do best, not what I can do.
Okay.
So, I've had a chance to write three productions, Veronica's Wish, Freedom, and another one called Hijab Cool. But I did that one in Turkey with some company. Now, what's there to talk about? I don't even know what to talk about, really.
There's a whole Wikipedia page. Should we pull it out?
I don't know what to talk about, really, because acting is, or getting into the art industry wasn't exactly something I wanted to get into. Mm. I just bumped into it by accident, and then everything, not far from what the guys, the gentleman there said, everything just started landing on the job, and then one thing led to the other. Why I'm a writer now is because I've realized certain stories, especially our stories, are told the wrong way. And I believe I have a son and I want them to be told. So the fact that there's a world I want to see out there, that's why I'm a writer, because I want to see my world out there.
Yeah.
Not something someone tells because they feel that's the perfect way to tell it. I want my world, so I'm a writer because of that. To produce sometimes because we are talented in so many ways, but certain talents are not yet unleashed. Mm. So in order to get to what you want or to get the best out of what you've created, you have to, you know, to have your hands dirty at some point.
Yeah.
Yes, so you have to do certain things your way.
Mm.
I've only produced one production, that's Veronica's Wish, and another one is on the way. Outraged.
Ooh, nice.
And another series coming on the way too at the moment. I just wish it's not something everyone takes for granted that, hey, when I have free time, I'll come and do this. So I love the fact that certain people really put their time and effort out there for art completely 100%, which is still new somehow. People are still taking it as part-time at the end of the day.
That's true.
That's what I want. That's my dream, maybe.
I like that. And
Nisha's wish.
I find it very interesting that every person seated here today has highlighted their focus on the art. And to be honest, that is how us as artists have been hoodwinked into doing jobs for free. So this conversation is very necessary. Yes, for the love of art, but does that mean you should sleep hungry for the love of art? Does that mean you should sleep hungry for the love of telling the Ugandan story? Let's talk budgeting and costing production. I'm going to start with Eric.
Yes.
Kunta Productions has so much work under its belt.
Yeah.
So much work. So for us on the outside looking in, we have decided you're rich, you make a lot of money because you have a lot of productions. Right? We are outside looking in. And my question to you is,
when I'm going back.
My question to you is, what does budgeting entail for one production? It doesn't even have to be the biggest production, but you sit down to, like, you know, this is the genesis. We are starting a new production and you need to look at the budget and you need to look at what's going to take from you. What does that process entail for you?
Yeah. So number one, everyone has a reason why they're doing what they're doing. Yeah. So you need to, sometimes you need to start from the end and you work backwards.
Mm.
You find a filmmaker or someone, you know, who is doing for us, who are doing TV shows. First of all, the markets are different.
Yeah.
Because at Kunta, we're producing content for Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda. Mm. The clients are totally different, and the markets are different. But then you find that, you know, our dream is to be the biggest production house in Africa. Mm. If you're going to maintain that, and that's where you're coming from, then your decisions will be different. There are jobs you refuse to take, there are jobs you will do. But then when it gets down to the budgeting, first of all, it's about the vision of each individual project. No project is too small, even though it's just one interview with just two cameras. Mm. There's so much detail in the budgeting, to the detail of airtime costs, you know, data, everything that, you know, entails that. Because, you see, what we do is no longer, you know, a pastime. Yeah, yeah, it's not just on the side. To some of us, it has become the main hustle. So if it's going to be your main hustle, that means you have to play with the numbers to the dot. So if you don't know how to cut your budget well, then you know there are two types of budget. Mm. There is the in-house budget, then there is the budget the clients wants to see.
Eh?
Yes.
Part A and B. Part Please, A break it B. down.
Let me break down part A. Right now, there is a client. I'm not going to say the name, but it's one of the corporate ones, a big brand. We present a budget to them. I don't know if we're going to lose a job for this one.
You probably won't.
Yeah, they are known to watch it. They are so busy. Yeah, so we present a budget and we put an agency fee. Mm-hmm. And then they were against the agency fee. They're like, you know, find a way of putting your money up there. This is not new.
Let me ask, is agency fee similar to like talent fee? So sort of like after you've put down all the costs, I need airtime, I need transport, now me, I need this money. Is that the same as agency?
Yes, because the thing. The client wants to know that you're giving me the true costs. Mm-hmm. And every industry has rates. You're not going to quote TV lighting, say for a set like this, because, you know, he'll go to this guy and finds out that, you know, no, the industry rate is this. Yeah. So first they're going to check, are you, you know, following the industry rates? And then eventually, Kunta Productions is in this for the business. So some clients will actually require that you even quote how much you're going to pay your producers, your directors, your editors, your runners, the floor managers, everyone.
Yep.
But at the end of the day, Kunta Productions has to stay, you know, with money because this project is supposed to leave us different. Mm. So that is what we call the agency fee, or sometimes in the budget, it's a managerial fee. But then if you don't know how to break down the figures to the last detail, then the client will never give you the money because they know you don't understand what you're doing. Mm. Because no client is going to take a block figure. So we're doing this series of competitions. It's 1.3 billion. How? You know? And then also, it depends. I don't know if I'm still talking about budgeting or costing, but how you cost your project will influence your budget. Mm. You should have a quick template of a budget that you're always working with, because sometimes when these clients ask for the budgets, they really want them really quick.
Yeah.
So you should have top of mind the information about, you know, the different moving parts of the machine that you know that you use and how much they cost, because a client will throw you a question when you're still in the pitching phase, roughly how much is this going to cost? You should be able to give an answer. So budgeting is key if you're actually going to grow and, you know, make money. It's very key. And then you should know the end goal. Which type of production do I want to execute, you know, at the end of the day? What's the quality I'm aiming for? Am I shooting below my belt? Or is it to the standards that Kunta Productions is known for? There you protect your brand. Yeah, and then clients over time will get to know, if I'm to work with those guys, they're expensive, but they give me, you know, they call it expensive, but honestly speaking, this market, in the East African market, as far as Zambia, I haven't met an expensive production house. That's why I like the fact that this guy is here. Yeah.
He's going to explain that to us.
You're
going to
explain to us, yeah, what happens in that boardroom of the TV station.
You mentioned something very important there, and before we get back to it, I want to hear from Nisha. You was Veronica's Wish your first fully produced film that you produced?
Yes.
Now, as a newbie, as a producer, because now you are at the top, you have to take all these things into consideration, your people, the costs.
Yes.
What was your experience budgeting for a production like Veronica's Wish?
Well, luckily, I had worked on other productions before, and I realized how difficult it is to work without a budget. Before you know it, you you're not shooting anything because you ran out of money. There was no budget. So at some point, I figured I didn't have enough for my, I knew the budget I needed, but I didn't have enough. So the fact that I knew I needed a budget of this much, certain things went easy. Why? If I do a product placement here, it's going to cover this, then that is gone. If I do a co-production with someone, then this is covered. Because I had a budget, but the one I'm dealing with, that this is going to cost this, this is going to cost this, is going to cost this. And if I don't have that in cash, how do I resolve that? So that's the part I went to, that I need this, I need sound. Who has the best sound? Quad A. I called Quad A. We made a partnership. So that's covered. A big, huge part of the budget is covered.
Yeah.
Yet I haven't even spent anything yet. So I kept on dealing with such things. Mm. So all I just had to do is, how much do I need and how the hell do I deal with it? Mm.
No, it's okay. No one, Facebook won't come for us. And we're going to get also into a conversation of where to look for the money. But he talked about something very important, the market price when you're budgeting. How do you how do you find out what the market price is? How do you get this information for a person that's just starting out trying to create a budget? Who decides the market price, even in film? Can you answer that?
Okay, I'm going to pick a bit of two leaves from both of them, Eric and Nisha. Nisha brings out a strong point, which I don't think we should even be contesting. Maybe the guys who are still starting up, but you will not move any project without a budget, be it in your personal life or anything. If you can start it from your personal life, you definitely know for a business you will.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, the second point that he talked about, costing, in the middle there, I'm coming to the same point, and I'm saying, for you to determine your market price, every person will have an individual market price. Mm-hmm. But before you come to that market price, picking a leaf from him, these tips are going to be important. Find out from the people who have been there before. Mm-hmm. I mean, get on the phone. Anyone there out there aspiring to be a producer, there are tons of producers in the lines, line producer, this and the other. But one of the key aspects of a producer that they will always have to do, whether you assign it to your assistant or something, is to get on the phone and you call Nisha and you say, Nisha, I need to have a conversation with you. Mm-hmm. I need you to be in an advert or I need you to be in a TV series. This is the number of days I'll need you. This is what will be provided to you. How much will you charge me? Mm. Then you write down those simple basics.
That's still in the process of budgeting.
Yes, you're coming to the budget. Mm. So you call a creative director, you call the grips guy, in the beginning you need to know the structure. There will be different structures, but as you go along, you will learn. A commercial will have a structure different from a TV series, from a feature film, from what you budget if you're doing something like a season or two seasons that you're taking to the TV. Mm-hmm. You need to look for that information. The third tip on that, after you've done a budget, you've found out the costs, have a minimum standard. This is what you call a minimum standard.
What's that?
That Eric, let me give you a good example. If Eric says you need him to film an interview, an NSSF interview, mm-hmm. according to his standard, he will say an NSSF interview requires me to have two cameras, a sound guy, and a lighting person. He knows from the initial conversation of what he has had on the phone, he knows the costs of those, which brings him down to say, I want $1,000 as a minimum standard, your starting phase. That takes away the issue that he mentioned. If a client on a snap calls you and says, I have an interview tomorrow, how much roughly, before you even send me the quotation. Mm. When you know your minimum, you will say it. I started with a minimum of 500K as a single person to step on your set. It went on growing as I realized certain things as they went on, said I can't be the cinematographer, the director, and the camera. Okay, I need to add people. Then I moved and I moved until I got to a standard where if you called me and you said, Sean, if I need your services for this, I will give you a standard. Mm. And I will tell you that standard constricts of X, Y, Z that I can be able to fulfill.
So are you saying that market price either grows with the person or the industry? How does, because yours
it
grew
eventually grows, uh-huh. but you need to have the foundation of how it grows. Mm. That's what I'm saying. That you need to know what the people out there have. Mm-hmm. Set your minimum as a person, because all of us here will not output the same quality.
Can my market price be the same as Eric's or be the same as Nathan's? How do you determine that? This is my league, and this is my league.
Yeah, I think we're confusing two things. Mm. Market price for how much a job costs, mm-hmm. and then there's what they call the standards in the industry.
Yes.
Yeah. So there are some items that should be the same cost as his. Uh-huh. No, he's explaining how he values himself as a brand.
As a person,
yes.
Okay.
But when it comes to budgeting, the items that should be similar, cut mm-hmm. across, mm-hmm. because, I mean, say, for example, if you're talking about equipment. Mm. If you're costing for equipment, there's a particular type of cameras. If you're quoting, say, for Blackmagic, there is a rate you won't go beyond. Mm. Yeah, because, you know, the supply and demand in the market has stated that, say, for Blackmagic, a rent of value, even though I own it, mm-hmm. it will be on the budget. Yeah, because yeah. every time that camera is out, it's working, it's depreciating value. Yeah. So I have to cost it, because that's the other way we make money. Mm. But that item shouldn't go beyond 300K, mm-hmm. for example. So if a client finds it at 600K...
Vary based on the client, because I think we've seen that happen, where you'll charge a particular client a bit more for certain equipment because they have the money, and then another...
That's unprofessional. That's cut out unprofessional.
I think you can't charge a client more for the equipment, but you can charge more, like, for the human resource.
For the human
yes.
resource.
Yes, because so, that one, a client can't contest it. If I'm telling you that
so
to
does
edit,
it not happen that
if
they
I'm
increase?
Telling you that I edit something for 2 million shillings, mm-hmm. that's what I charge. You can't contest that. Yeah. Mm. I mean, if you can't pay 2 million shillings, find somebody who can charge you what you have. Mm. So like the human resource, they can't contest that. Mm-hmm. So it's these things that, you know, they can go and buy, or they can call somebody and ask. Mm. They are the ones that they contest.
Yeah. Okay.
There are variables, but you see, he's very right. Because, you see, an editor or a DOP, yeah, mm-hmm. who went to Malaysia, invested, they came back with their degrees whatsoever, mm-hmm. and me, a Chanamukaka guy, who learned on the street, we might be valued differently.
You have different.
But you see, mm-hmm. you won't value that editor, even though he went to Malaysia, if your work is work. If yeah. it's fake, you're not going to fool a client. Mm. Yeah, but he's right. There are variables that, you know, can increase actually your budget up, and the client can never contest against, you know, what you're charging them.
I like that we've talked equipment, human resource. What do you, as a producer or as a creative engineer, Munange, the word is stuck. As a creative engineer, what do you consider when you're budgeting besides, you know, actually, not even besides, even inclusive of that, equipment, human resource?
Because the thing is this, that I don't know that somebody talked about it, that when you're budgeting, there's two things. Mm-hmm. Your costs, like the actual money that you're going to spend. Mm-hmm. So once you know that, then the other thing is just company profit.
Which, like, is it the one that Sean was talking about? Agency fee. The agency fee.
Yeah, guys, I mentioned in my profile, we started from the streets. Mm-hmm. And when I said I need to see a better Africa, it's because there are certain things we need to learn and unlearn. Over the course of the years, I've seen salespeople, I've seen producers and directors walk to a boardroom or somewhere and they present what you call the block figure. Boom. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And they threw it out there and they said, client, that's what I'm going to pay. And then you end up in the haggle. We all know how that haggle goes. How did you come to this? Tell me, how many hours do you work for? Can you, you know, they're trying to find a way. Now, yeah. I want you to note that in the next, and mark this word, in the next 3 years or even less, no one is going to be able to walk into that boardroom and fool a client, which means we need to clean up that section. Mm-hmm. I've heard in this conversation, and with no offense, the statement of, how do you call it, difference and stuff needs to be corrected. It is true, by all means, any business and people, and this is what I would say to all the young people out there, as you make your budget, for me the key tip at the top of the others is target 30, there's a rule, 30, 50, 70.
Break that down.
So 30, when you are starting up, 30 is what you're targeting as your profit. We need to make profits, guys,
30%.
At the end of the day. Yeah, 30%. Mm-hmm. So if I'm charging you 1 million, I need to target a 30. Mm-hmm. Some people, me when I was growing up, when I was being taught about it, I was actually taught 50.
Profit?
Yes.
Which world?
This world.
Uganda?
Yes, Uganda. And we're going to come to how we bring it in then and clean it up and make it reasonable. Mm. But at the end of at the beginning of it, you must know it has to happen. For one reason, you will not survive and keep presenting, and we will not find Nisha, the creator, and Eric here tomorrow for the next job if he can't pay rent, if he can't find food. We're not talking about a scenario where I pick 1 million shillings from Maritza, I give it out to the DOP, the creative and the actor, and I'm done. Doesn't happen. No. Mm. We should avoid that. So you shouldn't at the end of the day, and some clients actually understand it. Mm. True story, I've been in a meeting with a client and my friend tried to cut costs and the client asked, so how do you make money? Oh, you came to rob us. You don't want to hear that question again. Did you come to rob us? Because you're not making money.
How do you make
so if
money?
You're not making money, what are you doing in this boardroom?
That is
so that's a standard. It has to be there. It has to be there.
I'm going to have to cut you short.
It has to be there.
I'm going to have to cut you short. We'll come. Can you hold this fire? We need to come back with this fire because this is a conversation that is going to be so heated. Referee, you guys still haven't got us a referee, please. So how do you make money? Those are the questions you want answered today. And when we get back, our panelists will break it down. The clothes are coming out. This is getting exciting. You're watching the Film Hackers Talk Show.
Over 80% of Ugandans have no access to electricity, and using kerosene and open fires make daily tasks like cooking, studying, or running a business quite challenging. MKOPA is here to change this narrative.
MKOPA Solar Uganda was formed in 2013 at the base of the Nile River in Jinja, and has now expanded to all regions of Uganda where we have 21 shops. MKOPA envisions a world where everyone has access to clean, affordable power. MKOPA tries to make it easy for customers to pay by taking the amount that they're already spending on kerosene and batteries and phone charging, and instead get them to pay us that same amount at a daily rate over the course of the loan. And so how we do that is we ask them to pay us between 2,000 and 3,500 shillings a day using mobile money. After the customer has paid off their first loan, they have a credit rating with MKOPA. So we now know that they can afford to pay us a daily payment. And this is where we tell the customer, we say, what else do you want? And we're able to upgrade them to other products. So we're able to sell them smartphones, we're able to sell them televisions, we're able to sell them clean cook stoves, we're able to give them cash loans, we're able to sell them refrigerators. So MKOPA Solar Uganda has sold to over 100,000 Ugandan homes. So each Ugandan rural home has about 5 or 6 people, which means that literally 500,000 to 600,000 people last night had electricity because of MKOPA.
MKOPA, an amazing client in that they're helping reduce the power gap and bringing accessibility of power to over 30 million Ugandans out there. The relationship with M-Corp has started in 2013 when we opened accounts for them, and it has grown from strength to strength. This relationship has also extended to their staff members, and we're in the process of putting together workplace solutions for their staff members, because it's very, very important to have a happy workforce. I believe this partnership with M-Corp has brought about a real transformation in people's lives and brought great impact to the communities around us. For both Stanbic and M-Corp, it's an exciting and a very bright future ahead.
Stanbic Bank came up with an innovative working capital solution for M-Corp that has helped us access critical financing, which will enable us to grow our customer base over the next 2 years and beyond.
The thing that I love about M-Corp is the fact that we are changing much more than lives. I mean, we are changing both the customers' lives, but our staff's lives as well.
This facility has helped us to grow our customers from 80,000 a year back. We're almost hitting 100,000 customers, which is big. And in the future, we hope to grow by leaps and bounds. Not only that, we've extended this relationship to our staff. So we have staff now banking with Stanbic, and Stanbic is able to empower our staff as well as our customers.
Nalindi na masanyalazi. Ninganga ngo manye bya masanyalazi. Nimbalabala munga masanyalazi gali waguru nyo. Kwekwezi saa M-Corp Solar. Eche TV bati vachisubira. Nti tusolo kulabe TV nga ilikiria kusola. Kati bali kuchiraba. Ndaba wakwezi saa M-Corp Solar. Ato savinga nyo. Okusi ngo kwekwezi saa masanyalazi. Obane cho savinga nyo 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 chine ninyo. Amasanyalazi ni mga genda. Habana bange basikala bakulachi. Balaba TV era nivita wabasoma.
It's amazing the transformation impact of what access to electricity can bring to the communities around us. And at Stanbic, you know, we're all about transforming lives. It is partnerships like these that help us achieve our goal of creating a better tomorrow for Ugandans.
Stanbic Bank, moving forward.
Welcome back to the Film Hackers Talk Show. My name is Maritza. I am your host. And today we're talking budgeting and costing. And of course, you know that Film Hackers is the one stop for all your creative know-how information. Do you want connections? Do you want to know what's happening in the industry? Do you want to meet the key players, the key stakeholders? You can absolutely do that on all our platforms. And this would not be possible without Net Studios Africa, Garage Group, and Incredible Media. Now, panelists today, things are getting hot. And I'm talking to people who have been in this industry for over a decade. And when you have that much experience under your belt, you've really seen things. You're almost traumatized. Do we need therapy at some point to go through, you know, some of these challenges, especially money? Money. Before we went for a break, Sean was breaking down for us in terms of budgeting the 30, 50, 70. And I think you had sort of explained how the 30 should at least be a consistent profit for whatever budget that you're putting out there. And we had Nisha, who had several concerns with that theory and method.
Well, it's what he's talking about is not wrong, but the problem I'm having with all the gentlemen here, they're talking about a client. So client B, client C. So what happens when you have a client?
Let's actually talk about that, because I want a clear breakdown. I'm on the outside. I've never seen a budget for a production, whether it's a TV show, an advert. You call me and say, I have a 50K. Can you voice this for 2 minutes? And that's all I have to do with your production.
Yes.
So for someone like me who's never seen it, Nisha, you did a whole film.
Yes. Mm?
It's not like someone came and said, we have money for you, make us a film. How did you look for the funding? How did you create a budget? How did you decide this is how we're going to find money for this production?
Okay, well, why I wanted to ask about the 30, the 50, and what else was 70?
70.
The 70. Mm. So it's your own production. Maybe you're investing in your money or you're getting someone to fund your project. So are you putting that 30, 50, 70, as part of the money you're asking from the co-producer you're producing with or the executive producer? That was question one. Two, if I start saying I'm quoting this for a client and then I have a certain amount for the in-house and the outside house, when you were the client yourself, how are you dealing with both budgets? Because at the end of the day, one budget is bigger than the other, right?
When you say you're the client yourself, you mean you're the one looking for funding.
You are the project. The project is yours.
Let me ask, when you're doing a project, you want to make money.
Yes.
So why don't you consider the 30, 50, 70 as part of the profit?
The way he was discussing about his plan is he gets the profit from
somebody else.
From somebody else. And that wasn't
to the
case.
Product?
No.
So I want to know where you want the profit to come from. Should the profit come from after the fact, once the product is out, or from the initial funding of the product?
That's why I wanted him to clarify, just in case it's not someone's project. Mm-hmm. You're not just hired to do the job when you're the one hiring someone to do the job, because there's that part too.
If I am the person,
you're the client.
If I am the client,
yes.
If the production was yours and no one, you're not giving somebody a budget.
Yes.
No. You are hiring me to do your film, and now you want to make profits off the money you want to give me.
Yes.
That's the part I want to hear.
You're asking. No. I think I have understood. It came from the conversation where a client asked me, "How are you making money?"
Mm-hmm.
Right. As a client, as a client, I think this is an advanced client. First and foremost, I should state that that's an advanced client who probably has money and is bigger. And he understands that the company has to make a profit.
Mm-hmm.
The beginning guys don't usually get it, but the other guys will understand it. And he's not interested in how much I am making. It's simply the issue that you mentioned of two budgets. There was a mistake in that meeting. Someone presented an in-house budget. Mm-hmm. That budget doesn't actually need to go to the client. It doesn't.
Yeah.
It stays with Eric. You present this budget, which you know, cost price, I am assuming we know cost price and selling price, which you know that the cost price, when I take off what I am going to use as production costs, this is 30% my profit.
I still have
you understood
money.
Now?
Now, how do you quote that? I have a question. How do you quote that 30% on a budget? Because earlier you had said they asked you agency fee,
make it
disappear,
fix
it in.
Yes.
How do you quote that agency fee? And from your description, it kind of looks like the in-house budget is Maritza without makeup, and then the budget you give the client is Maritza with makeup.
No, explain the disparity.
No.
So here's the thing, it depends. You see, we're seated here, but we deal with different, types of productions.
Mm-hmm.
In the world I come from, for TV shows, mm-hmm. of which we've done, I'm happy to say we've done the biggest number of TV shows in East Africa at the moment. But you see, the scales of these productions are different. You find a production that sometimes can stretch to a billion. Mm-hmm. You work with percentages. Your agency fee is a percentage. Now, that's an international standard. It wasn't invented by myself.
Do the percentages come after you have been told this is how much you have, or do you present the percentages when you're asking this is how much I need?
This is how much it's going to cost me, mm-hmm. plus the grand sum should have your percentage, because you're not going to fool the client. Why are you doing this for me? Mm-hmm. So you can't start hiding things. Mm-hmm. And you know, so many young people are doing that out there. You know, so many people who quote. The client will see your lies, mm-hmm. and then they will go for someone else who is clear. And then sometimes you need to define who you are and the level of quality that you deliver.
I want that clarity.
Because ideally...
We are missing. You know what we're missing? We're missing that clarity. I feel like we're speaking in producer code.
No,
speak.
The thing is this, I want to help you with that. On who your client is.
That's what I want
so
us to
So there are clients who understand... Mm-hmm. That there is, okay, different industries. They'll put in some people, like in advertising agencies, they say it's agency fee. Mm-hmm. Some other, you know, industry, they say it's a management fee. Mm-hmm. And then in production, to be like a production fee. Mm-hmm. But then the thing is this, like I, Nathan, I own my own production company. So if I'm doing a job, I have to pay myself a salary. Mm-hmm. That is for me. Mm-hmm. But then there's got to be money going to the production company, because some production companies are owned by different people who are not even involved in the day-to-day running of the company. Mm-hmm. So the way production companies make money is actually two. Mm-hmm. Actually, not just production companies, but even agencies, whatever. The percentage and then everything that you quote for, you have to put a markup.
Nathan,
you have to mark up each and everything.
We're dragging. We're dragging.
A markup.
The
you see, this
thing.
Is why, Nathan, you're the reason why we have failed to standardize this industry. You get it? You see, guys, don't put markups on a camera. Yeah, because the client probably has been approached by him and by the other person, mm-hmm. and they know. You're not fooling them. They have dealt with different projects. Mm. What you can put a markup on is intangible items that are only particular to yourself, okay. like skill.
This is the thing I'm saying.
Yeah.
That
so as your
camera
charging,
is 100,000 shillings, a client has given you a job of, say, 20 million shillings. No client is going to contest 50,000 shillings that you put up as
a markup. There in the first place,
why am I putting it there? Because I don't want to have to put miscellaneous. Because these things, when you're budgeting,
so that's how when you're budgeting. Let me get this straight. So that glossing up that I was talking about, that's the
but
like
I've
equipment.
Said, I come from a background of advertising.
Glossing up the budget.
That's how the advertising works.
That's the budget.
That's
you can't sustain a business.
Eric, this is why I want a breakdown. I want a breakdown. That's why I wanted your breakdown, as you are the person looking for money, right? No one came to you and said, give us Veronica's wish. He has explained that he's going to make money from...
Markup.
And
then what? The commission.
The commission from the client. Mm. How, when you're budgeting, do you make money? Because yes, you have your costs. The 30% agency fee does not work for him. You have to gloss up the budget. You, as the person looking for money, how do you make money when you're budgeting?
For starters, you asked me how I budget. I budgeted my film, the whole film. Mm-hmm. For starters, everything begins with what kind of script are you working with? Mm-hmm. There's also that part. Because if you're working with, if it's let's say it's a village setting sort of film, what you're going to spend on that is not the same as you're going to spend on the urban kind of film. So mm-hmm. that also matters very much. So it depends on the kind of script I have. So if the kind of script I have asks for a lot in production design, then that means I'm going to have, because equipment is usually going to spend almost this, you're going to spend the same usually, mm-hmm. because unless if you don't want quality. But if you're working with the same quality you want always, the equipment is going to stay the same, the people you're going to hire are still the same. who are going to give you, who are going to bring value to what you want. Mm-hmm. Then this comes back to how much do you need in production design, how much do you need in maybe transportation. There are certain things that are going to be attached to the production that would not have been attached to the previous production mm-hmm. if it was a different kind of script. Mm-hmm. So I come to what Veronica's Wish. Let me use that as an example because it's the project that is there. Mm-hmm. So I have Veronica's Wish. I need expensive cars. I need this. I need good houses. I need this. All that I don't have, and all that need money. So if all that need money, how much? I start quoting for every piece, that
step by step.
Yeah. As he mentioned, I call, who do I want to talk to work with? Malaika. Hello, Malaika. Hi, it's been long. How much would you like to work for at this particular time? She says this. I say, oh, no, I have this. Mm. Before I even start budgeting, so mm-hmm. I know this is how much she might cost, and then I put that down. Mm-hmm. Then I call another one. Then mm-hmm. the crew, still the same. Mm-hmm. So now I know this is how much crew and cast will cost. I'll add in a little amount for just in case this happens or something happens.
How do you place that amount? That's the question. How do you place that amount and how do you expect? Because the idea of budgeting is you also budget how you're going to make the money, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you place that amount of just in case something happens?
Okay, me, how I do it, after everything is pinned down.
Investors want to see those numbers clear as day. Mm. So how he hides it. That's exactly why I want the explanation.
I'm going to tell you.
It's glossing up. It is glossing. Like, you know, you make it look pretty.
Honestly, you're misguiding these young people. Because now they are not going to have a standard to follow.
So, okay, we'll get back to that. So I want to hear, how do you make money when you're budgeting
for
like that?
For starters, his way is so wrong.
It's so wrong.
Advertising.
Anyway, it's advertising.
That is the standard of advertising.
Exactly.
And that is the thing. So many times, whenever you're doing a budget, you're not going to be on the dot for every line item.
True.
Some of the line items, you're going to spend less on them. Some of them, you're going to spend more. So where does that money, if you have to spend more, where does it come from? Because so many people don't want to see a line item miscellaneous. Or if it's there, you have to take it back. Mm-hmm. They don't want to see it.
But we've established that things like equipment cost the same, are usually standard.
No, they're not standard. This is the thing. It depends on where you got your equipment. Uh-huh. Okay, relatively, you would think that, you know, when you're seeing a camera on the internet, it says 9999. Mm-hmm. But it depends on where you're getting it. If you're getting it from, say, Dubai, mm-hmm. and someone's getting it from the United States, by the time it gets here, it doesn't cost the same.
I'm talking about people who are hiring.
And that's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying, that even people who are hiring, everybody has their own price.
No, which is what I had asked earlier, and you people, both Stuart and Eric, refused that. Because I was like, do you now sell your equipment, hire your equipment, say, aha, Eric has money, we shall add 50K, which is what you were saying.
No, because this is the thing. I've been doing events for the last 5 years. So many times I have to do, like, say, 6 cameras. Mm-hmm. So I had 2 cameras at Fenon. I go and hire 2 cameras from Patrick, the Muzungin Bunga. Mm-hmm. I get some 2 cameras from New Vision. Mm-hmm. The rate at which I get the cameras at New Vision, not the same rate at which I get them from Patrick.
Now, that's what I wanted to hear, the reality of the situation. There's the ideal of it's wrong to mark up, you know, like equipment price. Mm. As ideal as you say, that equipment price should be the same everywhere because the equipment is the same. Yeah. So you keep saying that is so wrong, and he's saying this is how the industry has been working for me. Yeah. Please, present your point.
Okay, so here's the thing. Don't get a client as good as you are to execution, and you put all your life's dreams in that budget. Because you know this is, you're charging Red Bull, yeah? Mm. So they should make me rich, so I'm going to quote 20 billion. Mm. Yeah, let me make the camera be 700K, yeah? I feel like that's so wrong. I think what we need to be passing out on is how do you do the budget? Number one, you need to have your entire team on board. Mm-hmm. So that everyone actually submits items. Then you need to be well informed about the market, you know, and what are the average rates of, you know, some of these things. You get it? Mm-hmm. So that even though you're doing the markup that he's saying, it's not just a greedy, glossy, dishonest way of charging your clients. Mm-hmm. Because trust me, dishonesty, me, I'm personally against it, mm-hmm. and it goes a long way, but they'll get you at some point. Mm. Be honest. For us, how we budget at Kunta, first of all, we begin with the Dreamer's Wish budget. What's the Dreamer's Wish budget? Part of, a clip that just aired, we wanted a shot of the River Nile. We had a choice whether to use a drone or to hire a plane. We hired a plane. But you know, that was informed by so many decisions and what we wanted to achieve. And we actually put it in the budget and made the client see why we want to do that, why it would add value. You can do an overhead shot while standing on a tree, climbing a tree.
A toy one,
or you can jump off a roof and you get the shot. But the one with the plane with, thousands of, a feet up is different. Yeah. And, you start to show this client why you want to do that, why you want to shoot this clip on water, but specifically a portion in the River Nile that has green, a green color on it. It's going to speak these volumes. So there is the wish budget. And then the wish budget is supposed to be connected to the output you're envisioning, the quality of the work you want to deliver. You let the client know. Because some clients actually now for Kunta, they have accustomed themselves to asking, can you give us three budgets? Class A production, Class B, and worst case scenario. Because you see, we're here, there are four cameras in this set. Yeah? But two cameras could have done it.
True.
Or one camera when we're just panning.
Yeah.
Yeah? Still, that's the product delivered. But then also you should have a baseline standard. Am I willing to use one camera and at the end I'm going to put Kunta Productions, Maso Kurutimbe? No. So, client, this is my baseline, But be genuine and honest. Now, the problem we have is these guys. You see, these guys, they are so caught up in their AC. The good thing with him,
your camera.
Yeah. The good thing, he has been on the street. He has been on the street before. Some clients, because Production House Z went there and quoted, say, a talent search, For what? 500 million shillings. You're going to go and you present, 2 billion, and it's going to be a hard time actually making them understand how different you're going to deliver. But let me tell you the secret. Branding and how you actually introduce yourself. You don't have to have done so much work. But the way you show up to a client will actually, it will say whether you look the money. You're asking for billions, but do you look like the billions? Go borrow a suit. Go to a graphics guy. Mukabirire, let's do this car proposal. Let it have bucolors. Let it be tasty. Go to NASA Road. Nice. Cut it. They're asking you for a synopsis, and you're sending a black and white paged thingy. And at the end, you're putting
document.
Billions. Exactly. The way you present yourself, get birthdays. Eh? I know you're still alone. You're the producer, you're the director. Don't say,
actor.
I'll do the budget. Yes, I'll get the camera. Say, the team will. But you're the same team.
Yeah.
You are alone.
Yeah.
A company, where they own a boardroom. Wow. You need to be smart. You get it?
So
and
the
then,
boardroom is with these ones.
Yeah, it's with these ones. The way you present yourself, your profile, what you've done, how you document yourself is going to add so much value to how much money you're asking.
That is such a heavy tip. Sean, over to you. Now, this guy has hired all his, not hired, has, gone to NASA Road, done his production, brought his $2 billion to you as Sean at NTV, all right? Let's talk about that. We, as UCC, actually, did, was this in 2006, when they required that 70% of content, broadcast content should be Ugandan, or at least speak to the Ugandan audience, right? With that kind of demands, not just from Ugandans, but also the bodies that run broadcasting, when a person comes to you like that with two times, three times, what's 500,000 and 2 billion? With like maybe four times, four times the budget of somebody else, and they break it down for you, make it look nice. What is happening with the team in the boardroom? How are you deciding, let's go with 2 billion, let's go with the 500 million situation? How are you deciding that this is something that the Ugandan people want to see, based on how they're going to execute it, and also based on what you've seen in their presentation? And, this may be cost less, but I think, what's that thought process? I want to know.
Okay, if you presented me with the two, the way you explained it, I'm assuming that person X and person Y both have productions they're going to produce. And you want me to choose who will likely I will likely take on.
The idea is it's the same production, just
yes,
one costs
just
more.
Just one costs more. Usually the logic is supposed to be that partly part of what he's saying, you can't go too low because I expect you to make money, mm-hmm. but you can't go too high because it's unsustainable. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, if you bring your production to the TV, you need to make money, I need to make money. We're both invested. You've invested in your team, I've invested in my infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So there's a conversation around me, you, and someone called a sponsor. Mm-hmm. Because we want to do Veronica's Wish 1, 2, 3, 4, a sequel, correct? So for us to do that, you've done your initial investment, we need to drag a third party whose ideas are similar or they want to pass a message on, and so we will bring them together. Now, if we're going to go to MTN, using as an example, and we say, MTN, I want you to give me 2 billion mm-hmm. per month. Mm-hmm. We need to extrapolate this further and understand, shall we be able to make 2 billion per month from MTN?
Do you put that in the budget of how you will be able to make 2 billion from MTN?
I'm answering the part where you've...
He's the client.
I am in the boardroom.
Okay.
You've brought me, Eric has brought me, and a person wires brought. Mm. So Eric has 2 million, mm-hmm. and another person has 2 billion. Mm-hmm. And we need to choose. Mm. And you're asking me what is happening in my mind at that stance.
Yes.
If I initially had a plan to run, because as you do a budget, you also have a plan for a year or two. If my plan was to have season one of that product called Kunta, and season two, and season three, I need to start thinking, Can Kunta produce season 1, 2, 3 at 2 million? And then I bring on MTN to add me 2 million so that we both can make money? Mm-hmm. Or is it possible for MTN to give me 2 billion? And I think that's where we need to strike a balance in the middle. Mm-hmm. Because 2 billion may become an extended, unsustainable thing. Never forget, the industry evolves.
Yeah.
The one element we can never hold and keep is that time factor. It will evolve. Mm. Tomorrow there will be another. I mean, it's the reason why we have people moving up and down, yeah? Mm. So at the end of the day, if I want to constrict it, it's likely 2 billion will constrict it to one season.
Interesting. So
and
longevity,
2 million,
is, one, longevity
exactly.
is one of the things you put in
yes,
consideration.
Yes. Mm. Unless if in my boardroom or whichever we were, we have agreed and said, you know what, we just want one season. But if he talked about, is it a product that the audience wants? Mm-hmm. I will look at the product, and there are products you look at and you're like, damn, this thing is beautiful. Mm-hmm. It might have started with about 1 million, but it's beautiful. Mm. And we need to push it high. And at that stage, we will say, okay, for us to do it, we need to move away from 2 million because its production quality is still low. I guess that's where it comes in about value. Mm. So we'll push it a little high and say, you know what? Let's help him. Let's bring MTN on board with 2 million and instead decide to run it at 4 million or 10 million.
How much will he make? That's another question.
That's
a question.
That's a question you
I
come to later.
Can I just ask him? Just one question.
Yes.
Please, because you see there are guys out there who are watching this stuff and they want to make money.
Yes.
And some of them have produced stuff. It's on their computers. They don't know how to approach a boardroom. Mm-hmm. I'd like you to be open and clear about how a TV station squeezes juice out of content beyond the money that is coming from. We are using MTN here, beyond the money that comes from MTN.
Because from the way you explain, that looks like a decent deal.
And you see why he's stretching?
That looks like a decent deal.
He knows it's a very uncomfortable question. Because you see these guys, and guys who are producers there, you need to hear just beyond the money. Sean, be honest.
So let me
create a context for you.
He gave us the context.
Yeah?
Now
no,
he just
no,
needs
the context
to tell us
for,
the truth.
For the producer. Uh-huh. I brought my show, it's called Maswanku. The quality isn't A class, but you can see it's going to trend. Mm. Yeah? Because there is a property actually that was maintained on NTV, wasn't bringing in a lot of money, but it had a lot of eyeballs, viewership. Mm. And you could see everyone struggling to place adverts within that block of time. Mm. You could actually tell these guys are making money. Mm. But you see, okay, I won't talk about what happened, you know, behind the scenes. We don't need that here. Yeah, so.
Yes, Sean.
Talk about that scenario.
The reality.
The reality of value beyond producers, beyond the content, because producers are downplayed sometimes in the boardroom to say, ah, no, this won't make money. Yeah, so we are going to pay you these little peanuts.
Okay.
speak not just for the big productions that you know air a lot, but also for movies.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I think his question is coming from a very solid background.
Hence reality.
Now,
that's what we want.
Reality. The question, I want to try and bring it still into the frames of budgeting, yeah? He's asking, if you went to the boardroom, how do we come to percentages? Someone mentioned percentages of how you make. And I'm not speaking on behalf of any particular TV station.
I'm going to speak
for the industry. So, and this applies not just the TV station, but it's also going to apply to you in your own company. There are TV stations that are going to give you a percentage of saying, give us, when you bring your product, when we bring MTN on board, we need to do what you call revenue share. So revenue share is we are agreeing, we want to give you, some people are going to say 30, we retain 70. Listen, I'm giving examples.
Wait, let me ask, in that example, in the 30 and 70,
why
do you then...
using that example?
No,
no, I'm still driving, there are many.
No, 30 is for the... So in
there are many.
Answer, help me with this. So 30, 70, if the station that has brought the sponsor keeps 70, do they also assume production cost, or it's just 30, 70 after the fact?
Interestingly, it varies. I've seen a contract that says if you bring the sponsor, you as Eric, you take 70, we take 30.
Okay.
And they also will tell you, if we bring the sponsor, we take 70, we give you 30.
Do they assume production costs?
No.
Sure, they have. I'm uncomfortable by the fact that in your example, you're using 30, 70. You're putting the 30 on the side of the producer, so because you said you're speaking for the industry.
When you produce your whatever, when you produce any kind of content, you would be crazy to think that you're going to get your budget from the one station that you sell it to.
Because that's not the case?
It's not, because you're supposed to, when you're getting into content production, you have to understand that it kind of takes a long gestation period. Yeah. That you could even take 10, 15 years before you break even. So don't expect that once I produce a movie of 20 million, NTV is supposed to give me 20 or 21.
So who's making the money?
This is the thing.
I'm supposed to
sell. I'm supposed to sell my movie to NTV. If we have agreed a license period of 1 year, I get the movie from there. I go sell it to somebody else. I keep going like that. I don't expect to get all my money from the same source. It doesn't work anywhere around the world.
Nathan is right, especially if their contract isn't, you know, airtight.
Good.
If it's not airtight.
I used 30, 70, and I am also making a disclaimer. If you went out here and you checked, there's 30, 70, there's 60, 40, there's 50, 50, there's 80, 20.
What is 30, 70?
All of them happen.
No. That is wrong.
If
there's a TV station doing that, that is wrong. And then the problem is sometimes if you're calling me on board as a partner.
Yes, that's a different conversation.
We should be clear. No, because you're saying we're sharing revenue, so we're partners, right?
Okay.
So can we declare our costs as well?
Yes.
Doesn't that also take into consideration how the connection happens?
Sorry?
Because the partnership, from what you're saying, if we're being partners, it looks like they sold you. From what he was explaining, you went to them.
No, that doesn't matter. Mm. As long as I can come and, you know, I'm requesting for a partnership, and then you agree. So,
50-50.
Don't squeeze me to the bone that I won't be able to do this thing that we both believe in. 30-70, very wrong. And I have a basis why I'm saying that.
Okay,
that's why
I'll also tell you.
By the way, as producers, have a lawyer somewhere who will help you understand these words. You know, they will put all these complicated, you know, so many pages of a contract.
I want to hear.
As a matter of fact, they are my bosses. But
I'm sorry.
Have a finance guy. Have a lawyer. Understand. You can actually carry them to that meeting.
And your sponsor, if you have. If you're the one bringing the sponsor, take your sponsor if you can.
Yeah, and then there are so many other arrangements. You can decide to buy airtime. again, these guys down.
That's what I was
you go, you rake all your monies, you pay them. Then there are so many approaches, but 3070, Sean, never use that example again in the industry.
Eric.
I feel like Sean was giving us the reality. Did you pull 3070 out of your behind?
Have you ever squeezed the producer to that extent, Sean?
I want to explain this.
It has?
If you're asking about 3070, I want you to be the TV station. Why? Mm. Yeah? Let's create a realistic road.
Does it cost the station?
For us to drive this, like, hold.
Why?
Hold.
There are costs.
Eric.
Eric, so ambiguous.
Eric, if we're going to run this, we need to drive it home. I am creating a scenario. Mm-hmm. This section here is TVY. Mm-hmm. TVY has invested in this infrastructure, all right? They pay for fees. Last time I was here, I explained. For you to create a TV station and run it, fees alone from UCC, Signet, Star Times is about 50 million. An infrastructure of a TV station today in Uganda that will run a bare minimum standard is 500 million to 800. So this TVY has invested 500 million, right? Mm-hmm. You've signed a contract. I am the salesman for this TVY, yeah? And you're saying, Eric, if you bring a sponsor, you take 70, you give us 30. 30 is for us to run our costs of daily, correct? Mm-hmm. We are also saying, if we bring the sponsor, we take 70, and Eric does what? Now, me, as the salesperson, TVY is going to call me and say, Sean, you have a target.
Yeah.
Step out there, confuse and convince MTN to come here and give us 20 million. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, if Sean delivers, Sean expects to be paid.
Commission.
And you also, now, you see, at the end of the day, why they're asking for the 70, they have tasked, you have invested in a person to hunt. The same way, Eric, who stepped out when we are giving Eric 70%, we didn't bring our salesperson, he didn't deliver. We're only maintaining these costs by the 30. Mm. Eric got his person, sent him out there and said, let's hunt, let's get Airtel. And he brought Airtel on board. He deserves the 70%. But I also say, this is not quoted in stone. You can negotiate. You can say, me as... We can also negotiate a TVY and we say, yes, we have the infrastructure. So,
hold on.
So,
I want to,
For the guys there, if you're a producer negotiate. Like me, please, 3070, never have such discussions.
I want to hear, I want to hear from Nisha.
Worst case scenario. No, I understand Sean as well.
I feel like Sean has made the point and we've also made our point. But I want to move on a little bit and hear from Nisha. Nisha, how did you make money off of, let's do Veronica's Wish?
As in after or before?
After. Ideally, it's after. You intended to make money off of the project once it was finished.
Yes.
How did you make money off of it? Because, yes, you had investors. Maybe you partnered with some people. They came in, funded it. But how did you make money? Was it one of those productions of Bana Uganda, free gift, here you go? Or was your intention to actually make money from it? Because the point of even budgeting to begin with is you want to know how much it's going to cost you before you can collect your profit, right?
Okay.
So how did you make money?
To begin with, and this is so wrong, please don't use this at home. I was doing this out of passion. I wasn't looking at where I'm selling it to begin with. In the beginning, and like, that's why I'm saying, don't do this at home. Exactly. So, but after the production was there, I have the film is there, things started changing. I started looking at where I can approach people who can buy this, who can buy that. And at the end of the day, with all these travels I kept on doing, I ended up selling it there. But that I didn't know that ideally before, that you can actually sell the project before you even do it, before even
tell us about that. Sell the project to whom? And when you sell the project, are you selling the rights or are you selling just...
Depends.
What are you saying?
When I say depends, so I'm going to sell it to a studio, maybe for just North America.
Okay.
That's a different area. I'm going to be paid for that, maybe 3 years or two, and then I come back to Africa. Who am I selling to? What's that? Cote Quest or whatever.
Cote West.
Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West. Cote West that. So I'm selling to them for a period of time as well. But in the same period as the other one, as I sold to the other people, and I'm selling to Coty Quest or West, whatever, Coty West, at the same time in the same period. And then I come back, there is Palm Magic. So these are things I should have looked into before even producing the film. But luckily, they came along the way. But these are things you can do way before you even start filming. And I've realized you can make money before you even film the film. Yes, and you won't even spend a penny on your film.
I like that. We're about to run out of time, so I want this conversation to not even inspire change, but to lead somewhere, to lead to something. How do we fix the disparities in costing, in production, budgeting in production? He has one side of the spectrum with advertising, the way they do things, and this is what works for Fenon. This is what works for you.
I admire his confidence, but then...
May I conclude mine?
On that particular point, in filming, first thing we all take for granted is production, product placement is key, very key. Like, we forget that, but everywhere, in Hollywood, in Nollywood, everywhere they use that. Product placement is the way to go.
Could you kindly define it?
What I mean by product placement...
In regards to making money.
Yes. So I'm going to... I write a film about maybe Kiprotich. So I'm going to go to... I'm going to go to Nike, I'm going to go to MTN, I'm going to go to a bank, I'm going to go to all the people that I know who give
Rosary
money.
Water.
I'm going to go to everyone who actually bring money on board. And then I'm going to start placing their products in every space that is available. And not to make it too much, I make sure whatever they give me is enough not to put a lot of products in my film.
Yeah.
Not to make it like a commercial for everybody. So I'm going to use Renzoli, he's a runner. I'm going to use Nike, not only him giving me the shoe, but the fact that every time he jogs, he needs to wear Nike. Nike is going to cover that with a lot of money because this is a film that is going to go all over the place. Then the bank. Banks, it is going to be, I feel like there is no way you can escape bank. Oh, it's on the way, or Coca-Cola, or MTN, people who actually bring money in advertisement. And this is the way to go. And before you know it, bam, your budget is covered. With just product placement.
Product placement, I like that. Yes, Nathan?
Yeah, I was saying that I admire his confidence, but I have a problem with some of the proclamations that he makes, because when Sean was trying to explain how they work at the TV, he was like, no, that's wrong. When I told him how I work, which is based on the advertising industry, which has been in existence since before he was born, and since before he started what? Doing production. He said, you're dishonest. I said to him that right now, if you go to a newspaper, they're able to design a newspaper for you. I mean, a newspaper ad, and they put it in the newspaper for free. You just pay for what? For the space. When you go to a radio station, they're able to write, record, and produce a radio ad for you for free. You just buy the what?
For free, yeah? So that's what they use us for.
Yeah, so like even if you go to NTV, they'll be able to design like a quick motion graphics what? Ad for you for free. But advertising agencies are there, and they're still making money. So why do you think? You think whatever clients are stupid, that you know they could go and get it here for very cheap, but then they're getting ripped off there? No, they are not. So don't say that we are dishonest. Because if I tell you that personally, I write a radio ad for 2 million shillings, yet you can get it for free at a radio station, fully produced. Don't call me dishonest.
I'm
producing 100 episodes for Power Magic. The budget for that, because I used a standard budget, a standard production budget, is 48 pages. I had 2 weeks to put together that budget. I don't have time to call each and every person to get a quotation from them. You know, what do you charge for this? I'm just estimating. I can get this for about maybe 2 million shillings, but to be safe, I may not get it for what? 2 million shillings. To be safe, let me put it at what? At 2.5.
No questions asked.
No questions asked, because what I did, the way it worked is that this was a commission project. So I have my story. They're like, you know, we are calling for, you know, projects. I put it in, so they give me a budget, and then, so like in my budget, I have somewhere where it says rights release. Because now it's my story, Once I give it to them, it's theirs.
It's theirs.
What do I put there? It's only me who can determine.
It's entirely up to you.
It's only me who can determine. So, like, you know, I've made money from the rights. You know, some things I've kind of, like, marked up. But that's just to keep me safe. Because for times when I've under-budgeted something, I'm safe. They don't want to have anything miscellaneous here.
Mm.
And then there is what? A production fee. So basically how it has happened is that, like, you know, I've sold them the idea, but then they've paid me to produce it for them.
Yes. That's how he's making his money.
Okay, so
Eric, I want to first give you time to calm down.
What we forget?
I'm joking, go on.
So me, I'm here on this Film Hackers, not for myself. It's for the young people out there.
Mm.
Times are tough.
Mm.
You know, these things we are doing and what we are saying here, we might take lightly, but there are young people out there. It's shaping them. They're actually writing notes. Please, and I beg you, yeah? Everyone here has experience, and you know, that's where we fetch from. Never be dishonest in your line of business. Don't be unprofessional. And I'll call dishonest the way it is. That is dishonest.
So what's your
idea? First, wait, you no, see, yes. Elaborate when you say dishonest.
Let me elaborate why it's dishonest. Ideally, if I'm the client, my relationship with you know, the TV is a beautiful one. But if I'm the client, I wouldn't want a person to do that to me as well. You get it? Because what she said at some point,
like what you don't understand.
I'm defining the dishonesty.
Understand. Can he first finish elaborating?
What you don't understand.
I want him. No. I want him.
I thought it was
Nathan,
my chance.
Nathan, hold on. I want him to finish elaborating.
Finish.
Yeah,
so
the dishonesty.
Please, once you're making a budget, yes, that's how he does his budget. But I'll tell you, he has dealt with so many clients, gotten away with it. Probably he won't get away with it for some clients. You see, all of us here have experience. Yeah, I told you we have done the biggest number of TV shows in East Africa. So I also have somewhere I'm coming from, and I've also experienced some negatives of just sitting, listen, dreaming.
Which is fine.
2.5.
Don't make what
wait,
you
let
do.
Him finish.
Listen,
wait, let him
Nathan.
Don't make what you do.
Is it still?
I thought it was my
Nathan.
Turn.
Nathan.
Yeah. Okay. Here. You see, that's a problem. Why the industry is the way it is, because it's so unprofessional. There is no professional ethics. Tulingaba, yeah.
That's what
that's
I want
why,
to
say. You see, they confuse even our hairstyles. They're like, yeah. Here's the problem. Because you're showing up, you're telling lies. You get it, eh? Because you want to become so rich over this project. And then the other problem that I've sensed is the working in isolation. I don't want my team to know how much we are earning. So let me dream of the budget fix this year. It worked last time. Let me do it. Have a team. Have, you know, someone who deals with the accounts. Someone we haven't talked about is someone who enforces the budget. Yes, you're the CEO, you're the owner of this company, but don't hold cash on set.
Don't
give it out. Get an accountant from Chambogo, respect. An accountant from Chambogo with a diploma. You know what happens on set?
Yeah.
This isn't around. We never budgeted. You start churning up because you're passionate. You want the project
to work.
Isn't
that the gaps he's trying to fill in by marking up the budget?
If the question is about marking up, his approach is totally unprofessional and dishonest. You don't dream of a figure and you put it out there.
But he's saying...
It should be informed.
In 2008...
It should be informed.
Hold on.
We did divisions for 8 million shillings.
Mm-hmm.
Divisions Went was one of actually the first Ugandan film to be screened at the Berlin International Film Festival. That's one
again?
Of the biggest film festivals.
Could you kindly say that again? You did what for how much?
We produced Divisions, the feature film, for 8 million
eight
shillings.
8 million.
2008.
Shillings?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
And then it went
Eric
to...
Is quiet.
It premiered. It premiered at the Berlin International Film Festival.
Mm.
Of course, when you go to that festival, you meet people, they want to work with you, they can't believe you've done what? Such a product.
Uh-huh.
So if he's telling you he wants to do something else with you, you're not going to tell him that what? It costs 8 million shillings. Because to them, hiring a camera for a week is 20 million euros.
Mm.
So if you're working with such a person, you have to come to their level.
That's the thing I told you.
That's the thing I told you. That when you are doing something for the World Bank, if you're doing
you're
a documentary, if you're doing a documentary for the World Bank, even if it really costs you 4 million shillings, when you tell them it costs 8 million shillings, they will think you're a joker. Because to them, they're...
Okay.
You're being FBI.
Okay. Okay, now, now I feel like...
Don't do street approaches where you have to lie.
No, it's true. Yeah. That's the same thing that like,
I feel like these points have been drilled in for majority of the conversation.
Like, even the 8 million that we produced, when you see the interviews, we are talking about 10,000.
No, but you're so
bad. Because even at the 10,000, they don't believe you can do
what. Nathan, I want to ask Nathan one question. Are you a filmmaker or a businessman? Because you're sounding like you're from Chikubo.
Okay.
Here's the thing.
You can't be both.
We are here.
Okay, I'm going to. This point has been drilled in.
No. Nathan is my friend. My new friend.
I mean, I get that.
But here's the thing.
I feel like we are dwelling.
Eric. Not to brag.
Yeah.
I'm one of the most qualified producers in Africa.
Yeah, but those ethics, my friend, are marking up figures.
They are told.
No, you're sowing a wrong discipline.
That's what we're failing to grow. This is what I'm saying, that
lies.
You have experience.
And then chaps are going to come from
SA. Experience.
They're going to be super, detailed to their budget. And projects are going to start going to Kenyans and South Africans.
You have experience, which is fine.
Honest.
You know, you have experience, which is fine.
This is what it takes to do my work. It's going to... Quote that for you, not one Nasudeo Sato.
You have your experience. My problem is you thinking your experience is the standard.
No,
it's not.
I'm saying
it's
honesty
not.
Is the standard.
I am honest.
This honesty
because I've told
is not
you
a standard in
this
business.
Whatever.
These are international business
human
standards.
Human resource.
Eric,
there's no standard
Nathan,
in the human resource.
Let's get back. Let's get back to the middle. Because I feel like
I say to you,
hold on,
there is
Nathan.
No standard to the human resource because that's why client
hold
is
going
to argue with you about a talent's costs.
This is what I want
movies,
us to do.
When it comes to the costs of equipment, pretty much all films, Hollywood films, everything, they should pretty much cost the same, less than a million shillings. But you know why we have films of 200 million? It's because of the talent cost. Nobody debates about that.
This is what I
it
wanted.
Costs what it costs,
this is what I wanted
it
us to focus on. Because the truth of the matter is, Nathan is not the only person running business like this, as we're calling it, marking it up or dishonesty.
It's
however,
thing
we choose.
That glance around here.
But then, no, it's not standard as well. Because the same way you're saying he shouldn't
understand it,
Nathan.
Like I was
Nathan,
saying, I don't know who you deal with.
Nathan,
10 years in advertising industry. Clans understand the markup.
Nathan, he's not entirely wrong, but the same way Nathan is saying what Eric does, you don't standardize your way, the same way I think Eric is also saying don't standardize your way. So is there really a standard? And is it too much to ask to strive for one? Because that is the goal. If we are going to make money like Eric, you're saying, you want longevity in the business. You need to be able to be honest, you need to be able to deliver regardless of how much more it's going to cost you in production, right? When it comes to all that, do we need a standard? Not just, yes, you claim talent fee, no. Do we need a standard costing or budgeting in the industry? Is there a standard way to do things?
I'm going to just say one thing. We need professionalism.
He says you can't have a standard.
Because even if you've done 20 commercials, every commercial is different.
Let's hear from Sean.
I'm going to tell you why I say you have to have a standard, because today, I do not know how you came here, but whether it's a border or a car, if those costs keep varying every day, today you use 5,000 to come here, tomorrow it's 10,000, the other day it's 30,000, it becomes unsustainable. So you need a standard.
No, you can't
and
have a standard.
Listen.
You guys are in
let, TV. Let him finish.
Forget
let him
about
finish.
TV.
Let Sean
I'm not
finish.
Even talking about TV. Forget about
he's
TV.
He's done away
the
from TV.
The reason why you
saying,
want,
you
the reason why you have a parliament,
uh-huh.
listen, the reason why you have a parliament, the reason why you have a constitution, the reason why you sign an agreement is to have some sanity in your flow.
Like a platform.
It's called a standard. If you don't create a standard, if you don't create a standard, nothing will thrive. That's for sure.
Let me tell you this.
Very unsustainable.
Like in the developed countries, in Hollywood, they have all these unions. Do you know what the work of the unions is?
Standard.
Is to standardize.
Yeah.
But then you have an actor who you can pay 100,000, you have an actor you can pay 20 million shillings. So you start from somewhere, but you really can't have a standard.
But then I think that dishonesty was coming from things like marking up the cost of production, like equipment,
which I was saying
like
that this markup thing is a thing that is understood in certain industries that even clients are not querying it. Like I said to him,
Nathan, you guys are the reason. You see now, that's the problem. You're already a successful guy in this industry. But you're sowing katua to these young people. Because now there is a guy, okay. He's a mulokole. He's into this business.
Yes.
He doesn't know how to lie.
Yes.
You're asking him to do a budget where he dreams of figures.
Eric, are you that guy?
That means, sorry?
Now, are you that guy? You have spoken for that guy the entire show, right? Are you that guy that does everything by the book?
So here's the thing. Everyone tries, to be honest. Yeah? But for me, what I see is lacking in this industry and why these guys are here is because of some attributes of professionalism they have carried up. You get it?
Would you also say transparency?
You see, transparency and honesty are in the same neighborhood. They stay at the same block. But all of them, that's why they're two words. They're different. You get it?
Yeah.
You see, you need to differentiate between a businessman and a creative. That's why it's good to leave the creatives handle their job. If you want a rugged, you know, chikubo, sorry, no offense.
No, it's okay.
We are Ugandan.
Yeah.
Fenatuvaku Street, you get, eh? But if you want that person to actually excel and push your creative work and sell it out there, then get someone designed for that. But trust me, something about dishonesty, eventually it catches up with you.
Okay, we're moving on to another conversation because I want us to continue the dishonesty light. Kabajeti katono. When producer Nisha has left. Nisha, what stories were you telling your people? When a person responsible for a production approaches the talent, maybe approaches the camera crew and any other person that you will need on board to make this production happen with the conversation of kabajeti katono, what is the expectation there? Because this is considering that the other person is now going to invest in your project. If I am using my own transport, if I'm paying for my own lunch, if I'm working for free, I have essentially invested in your project. Is there an arrangement after kabajeti katono for this person to make the money back that they invested in your project? And is there a way that they can have a stake in that production as investors?
It's not just always about money, but it's, again, I bring you back that it's all about value. That value doesn't necessarily have to be in monetary terms. Somebody is bringing whatever they are bringing because they believe in this project is going to go so far, and they would need the credit. They need to be attached to this project.
So the credit is what they take as opposed money.
Yeah. Because so many times people are not making money.
Is it okay to settle for exposure in 2020?
Oh, let's talk about exposure.
Quick. Credit is not exposure.
Let's hear from Nisha.
Credit is not exposure.
Explain the difference.
A credit means the fact that I'm giving you credit to be my co-producer. Somewhere along the lines, we discussed how much you're getting for that credit.
Okay, so credit equals money.
Yes.
It's value.
So if, now, if my credit on someone's movie will not translate into money, maybe at a later date, it doesn't have to come from the person who hired me, but maybe at a later date, isn't that exposure?
No.
Not really. If you're going to be paid at the end of the day, that's not exposure. Like, you're still hired, you're going to be paid.
It's kind of hard to explain credit to a lay person. But look at it like, say...
CV?
Kind of CV, but okay, now just look at it like, it's a degree.
It's a degree. So credit has the same something value like as
that.
A degree.
Something like that.
Okay. Like, now you talk about exposure.
Yeah, so exposure...
It also depends.
Yeah, to a talent out there, please be careful of guys who speak of exposure. Some of them just want to rip you off. They are holding on to money sometimes. But then sometimes the budgets are not there. So I feel like film hackers, we need to make more resources available to some of these guys. All the guys here have markets they know that, you know, buy content. Someone mentioned, you know, you're gonna sell a property, like he mentioned, here, there, and there, and there. So the here and there is what those guys want.
Okay.
I'll be willing to show guys where you can sell content beyond what probably NTV is going to buy it at, and how you frame a contract, for example. We can toss up some, you know, draft contracts, draft budgets, so that these guys, you know, can pick a leaf. But the thing about exposure and credit and value is that sometimes the owners of the projects or the producers, they fail to sell the vision to this talent. Yeah, to know that, you know, we're going to take it this far, this far, this far. So can you quote for us your value right now? But we're not going to meet it now. But if you see this and this and this and this happen, selling it here and there, just know we've hit the jackpot, we shall meet that value. Yeah.
Remember what
and,
Eric said?
Just lastly, lastly.
Let him finish because he won't speak again.
Yeah, I won't speak again.
The show is over practically.
Yeah. Lastly, actually, if you're a producer out there, there is something called Afroflix that, you know, I'm a part of, that, you know, that we came up with. Is for any producer in Africa. If you have content that is, you know, dope, just reach out to us at Afroflix. We're willing to buy the content.
Nice.
So there are so many people like that beyond the TV stations.
All right, Nisha, also closing remarks?
Yes, what I wanted to add on to kabajeti katono. It doesn't mean they're not going to pay you. Literally, they are saying, tugenda kusera.
Oba, that hurts more. That hurts more. But any closing remarks? Any closing remarks?
Yes, anyway, thank you for inviting me here today. I'm really honored to be here. And oh, thank God I met Eric. Now I know how to call Nathan. He's from Chikuma.
Yes. Nathan, final remarks?
I feel like the whole science to budgeting is kind of like leveraging your what? Your connections. There's so many times you want to do something and you don't have the money, but then maybe you've done somebody a favor and they owe you a favor back and you're able to
butter
go through
trade.
Like that.
But I like that. Producer Sean?
I really don't know what to say, but budgeting, I would say I'll pick a leaf from this whole set, from everyone. I will take his point to start with. You can't be dishonest. It's not even just production here. Forget about this stuff.
Everything.
It's a rule of living of business. You can never thrive if you're dishonest. Unfortunately, we haven't gotten time, but I would have broken down for you. You don't even have to hide the costs. You can actually spread them. There are things like rentals. People like TV stations hire people. I will hire a camera person. I will pay him 2 million shillings. The markup that we're talking about, I will mark up when I am putting it on my budget that a cinematographer will cost you 2.5. I am marking it up by 500, which is contributing to my 30% or 50% I talked about at the beginning. I'll put my rental, but I'll also make sure that I want to drive to be able to keep you as a client because I have a bigger plan ahead. I didn't mark it up by 4 million, please note.
Yeah.
I marked it up by, and then still in the same regard is don't be dishonest.
Don't be dishonest.
Always and always from her point, don't assume. I have seen worst case scenarios when you assume Maritza will take 50,000. You reach and Maritza says, hey, I am in Rukunjiri. So to get from Rukunjiri to where you are is already 100,000. And you start telling the client my journey. So don't assume, get on the phone, call everyone, find that. And the last one, yeah, I don't disagree with markup. By the way, about the markup,
let's not
I said
get back
markup
into it.
Exists.
This is a rabbit hole.
Because we don't have policies that are standard for now, be careful where you want to go. If you want to go quick, fast, these rules we know. If you want to do one job and get out, please charge the guy to be 40 billion and walk out. If you want, keep here. And the last one, I will stick with a 50. Whatever you do, any business, try and target your 50%.
50% profit.
50% profit. It's easy. I think all these guys, like Eric said, everyone has, you can pick a mentor from all these guys. And there's lots of people. There's Shafiq, there's... Find out how do they do their thing. If you came to me, I'll show you, and it's completely open, and the client will know. Then the Katono thing, my version is different. I'm going to say Katono for exposure, for a starting person, they have given you their view. You can take it. I think sometimes it's worth it. If you're starting out, you need as much exposure. When you reach a certain stage and you grow, yes, when you're starting out, when you're starting from zero,
Go on.
When you get to a certain level X and you have enough exposure, you will determine your price. My answer to a client who says Katono is, if it were an ad, for instance, I will ask the client, if I wanted more, I'll ask them, how much is your advertising cost? Sometimes you're going to realize that the advertising cost is 30 million. You want to give me 4 million for the ad. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
I am giving you something that is going to run 20 times on that TV.
Yes.
So why don't you up? And then I'll ask you, how much do you think this ad, when created well with Nisha and the creative and Eric, will impact the society? You're looking for value. What I am simply saying, you can negotiate and move up away from Katono. The space is there. Just know how to have the conversation. It's about adding value to the client.
I'm going to invite everyone that's watching today to slide in Nisha, Nathan, and Sean and Eric's direct messages. They have spoken well, and they have clearly spoken like they're here to help. Eric straight up opened up his platform to you. So this budgeting thing can actually be done easy. It does not have to be the cause of stress in your production. And I like that this has been a very honest and open conversation. So share it with your friends and continue in the comment section. We always follow up as Film Hackers and myself and continue some of these conversations. I'll invite you, our panelists today, to also go into the comments and find out what the people are saying and reply to some of those. Thank you so much for watching. Happy Independence Day. I am very privileged and honored to have spent that with you and with our panelists here today. Ah, Baseleb, let me even sit properly. And you can catch this show again next Friday, the Film Hackers Talk Show. This would not have been possible with Net Studios Africa, Garage Group, and Incredible Media. My name is Maritza. I've been your host. We're out.